Good afternoon, dear students. I welcome all of you in continuation with the lecture on the bloodstream and cardiovascular infection. And today I'll try to cover rickettsial infection. As you know all, rickettsia is a major morphological group of bacteria. So we'll be covering the rickettsial infection in today's lecture. Namaste, good afternoon, Sat Sri Akal. Welcome to the rickettsial infection class. To be very frank, I have started reading rickettsia since my second MBBS class, but much of the things are mucked up. Say, rickettsia is such a tiny organism that it is difficult to visualize it. Frankly, I have not seen yet the real rickettsia in any of the slides. Only the photographs, that too occasional, are being seen. And clinically also very vague picture is there. They say that it is divided into typhus group and the spotted fever group. So all the rickettsial infections lead to clinical symptomatology, which can be categorized into typhus group or the spotted fever group. So a fever where spots, the exanthematous lesions are there on the skin, they are the spotted fever groups. The typhus fever group, typhus means clouding of the consciousness. So it is seen that there is confusion in the patients because of the temperature, because of the fever. So that is why it got the name typhus fever. But then there is a intermingling in typhus fever, there is a spotting in the spotted fevers, there is a fever and clouding of consciousness. So that is a vague entity, vague clinical entities. But then organisms so far have been studied, and those organisms are known collectively as rickettsia, in the classified in the order rickettsial. So as I have said earlier, this is a major one group of the organism, and this group of the organism, this morphological group of the organism, is known as rickettsia. So we will see how the rickettsia are, their infections are, their laboratory diagnosis are. So that is the today's topic. The actual thing which you are learning in this lecture, that is the rickettsia, is this. This is a slide prepared from hemolymph of the tick and stained by the Jimenez stain. These tiny organisms are not easily seen by the optical light microscope. So we will see in the other slide why it was thought of the virus. So this is the organism, this rickettsia rickettsii. And this organism and other brothers and sisters of this, they live in these arthropods. The mite, the tick, the flea, and the lice. This is the head louse, and this is the pubic louse. So the organisms, they give shelter to the rickettsia. And from these organisms, who get the shelter in the man or other mammals, they infect the man or other mammals. And this cycle of this goes on. And there is transovarial infection also from the infected arthropod to the eggs which generate the infected larva, which develops into infected adult. One of the major morphological group of bacteria, small non-motile gram-negative coccobacilli, obligate intracellular organisms, not cultivable in artificial media, but grow in cell lines, animals or eggs, transmitted by orthopod vectors such as tick, mite, flea or louse. In fact, the vascular endothelial cell, that is the final target site of the rickettsial infection. So these six character, fundamental characters, if you remember, you are remembering the core of the knowledge of the rickettsia, which is needed. Classification, the order rickettsial has got two families, Rickettsiaceae and Anaplasmataceae. The Anaplasmataceae contains four genera, and which are spread, many species of which are spread among the mammals, and it's a wider spread of the family, and we will not discuss this here. The other is Rickettsiaceae, and there are two genera of the Rickettsiaceae, Rickettsia and Orientia. We will see these two here. Some members which were earlier there, Coxilla and Bartonella, they are excluded from the family because Coxilla is not arthropod born and transmitted by inhalational mode. Also, the Bartonella, which is not an obligate intracellular parasite and can grow in cell-free media, these two are excluded. So we will see them separately, Coxilla and Bartonella. Then there is an important question which arises about the Rickettsia. Are they virus or not? Earlier, they were thought to be viruses. So because of the small size and obligate intracellular parasitism, they were thought to be virus. But later on, it was decided, confirmed that they are not viruses, but they are bacteria. Why? Because they possess gram-negative cell wall, contain both DNA and RNA, multiply by binary fission, susceptible to antibacterial agents, large enough to be seen under the light microscope, and they are held back by bacterial filters. So these are the criteria why they are bacteria. Little history goes with the name. The Rickettsia name is kept after Harvard Taylor Ricketts in 1911. These scientists discovered that Rocky Mountain spotted fever is transmitted by tick. And Rickettsia provajaki, one of the Rickettsia, one of the major Rickettsia, named by Henrik de Rocha Lima in honor of Provojak. Provojak was the scientist who did work on the Rickettsia. Both von Provojak and H. Ricketts died of typhus, which they contracted during their study. Very sad that the pioneer worker, the lead worker for this organism, this group of organism, died. Then we will see the Rickettsiaceae family infections in brief. As we have discussed earlier, the Rickettsiaceae comprise of the two pathogenic genera, Rickettsia and Orientia. We will see rickettsial infections. So, as I have said earlier, rickettsial infections can be categorized into two classes based on the clinical manifestation, the typhus group and the spotted fever group. This is the table. The character, the species, the broad group, the species, the disease, vector, distribution, presence of rash, SCHAR, lymph node and Wheal-Felix reaction. So these are the basic study criteria for the rickettsia. So endemic typhus, Brill-Jenzer disease, and epidemic typhus, Brill-Jenzer disease, and endemic typhus are by Rickettsia provajaki and Rickettsia typhi, transmitted by louse and flea. And the worldwide distribution is there, almost worldwide. And in almost 80% cases, there is rash, presence of rash, and SCHAR is not present in both. Lymph nodes are not found in both. And Wheal-Felix reaction, the OX19 is very strongly positive, and OX2 is doubtfully positive. And in Brill-Jenzer disease, which is a recrudescence disease after years of the unfebrile or without any symptom period, there is a reappearance of the disease in Brill-Jenzer disease. Then endemic typhus, the OX19 is very strong and OX2 is doubtfully positive. Similarly, in spotted fever group, the important species are Rickettsia rickettsii, Rickettsia conori, Rickettsia africi, Rickettsia acari, and they cause Rocky Mountain spotted fever, Indian tick typhus, African tick typhus, and rickettsial pox. And they are all transmitted by tick except the Rickettsia acari, causing rickettsial pox, which is transmitted by mite. They are distributed in the America, Europe, Africa, and Turkey, Mexico. And relatively, the presence of rash is more in spotted fever group. And SCHARs are also more, presence is more in general in the spotted fever group. The lymph nodes are found to be enlarged, and Wheal-Felix reaction is relatively lesser strong. Rickettsia acari does not give, all are negative, while the medium strength Wheal-Felix reaction is positive in the Rocky Mountain spotted fever and Indian tick typhus and African tick typhus. Same, the third category, the typhus group or the spotted fever group, the third category according to earlier classification, now it can be grouped into the typhus group. This is produced by Orientia tsushugamushi. Orientia is another, it's not included actually in this Rickettsiaceae. So this family, this genus is separated, this is excluded from the Rickettsiaceae. So it causes scrub typhus. It is caused by a mite. It is prevalent in Asia, rash is there, SCHAR is there, lymph nodes are there, and OXK, not the 19 and 2, are present strongly in Wheal-Felix reaction. The antigenic structure, we have already seen that their cell wall is similar to gram-negative bacteria. They have got two major antigens, outer membrane antigen, outer membrane protein antigen, OMP, or the lipopolysaccharide antigen. And OMPs are species specific, highly immunogenic, and they are used for vaccine as well as for serodiagnosis. The LPS are group specific. They are found in Rickettsiaceae and is shared by some strain of the Proteus. The OXK, OX19 and OXK, three Proteus species share the LPS antigens of the Rickettsia. Pathogenesis, they transmit by arthropod vectors, the tick, mite, louse and flea. They spread through the lymphatics as a portal of entry, multiply in the regional lymph nodes, and then spread via bloodstream to be resting or finally multiplying in the endothelial cells of the vasculature. Then they are phagocytosed by adhesion to the epithelial cells OMPA and OMPB present on the rickettsial surface. They allow them to attach on the endothelial cell, and endothelial cell phagocytose or endocytose that, and the organism gets inside. Then inside the endothelial cell, these organisms, they resist lysosomal killing by inhibiting phagolysosomal fusion. That means the lysosome is unable to fuse with the phagocyte, and if the lysosome is unable to fuse, the organism will not be killed. So in the phagocyte, the organisms are multiplying with binary fission, and the generation time here is relatively long, 9 to 12 hours in comparison to the Escherichia coli or other organism, that is 20 minutes. So fairly long generation time is there, so infection will be relatively slow. It will build up gradually. And then cell to cell spread is by actin polymerization in spotted fever rickettsiae and by cell lysis in others. Now the endemic typhus or the louse borne typhus, the typhus which is transmitted by the louse. The organism causing this fever is R. provojaki, Rickettsia provojaki, probably the first one to be discovered, and the vector is the human body louse. The body louse gives eggs into the clothing, and in between they take the blood meal from an infected person. They get infected, and then the infection is transmitted to the other host, and the cycle goes on. So the epidemic typhus is louse borne, and by rubbing or scratching of the abraded skin or mucosa contaminated by louse feces allows the entry of the organism. Rarely inhalation of the louse feces or during the laboratory work exposure or during bioterrorism, the transmission of the endemic typhus, that is Rickettsia provojaki, can occur. Clinical manifestations: it is an acute febrile illness accompanied by headache, myalgia, eye discharge and rashes. After an incubation period of 1 to 2 weeks, so there are rashes, there is myalgia, and the complications of the interstitial pneumonitis along with the CNS involvement manifesting as mental confusion and coma may also be there. Risk factors outbreak occurs when louse population increases due to unhygienic and crowded condition, and in zoonotic cycles which also exist, eastern flying squirrels and their lice and flea maintain R. provojaki in the environment. So they are the reservoirs. Geographical distribution: it is endemic in Africa and South America. Burundi outbreak in 1997 involved nearly 1 lakh people in refugee camps. So the endemic became epidemic. So this also, now when there is recrudescence after many years after the acute epidemic typhus, so when initially there is an acute epidemic typhus, there is a gap of maybe years together, and then the disease again flares up. This time this is known as Brill-Jensen disease in the name of the discoverer instead of the epidemic typhus. And the Rickettsia provojaki remains latent for years, And probably the reactivation is because of the waning of the immunity. Then the endemic typhus. The endemic typhus, also known as murine typhus, this is caused by rickettsia typhi infection, and the vector here is red flea. The zoological name is Gynopsella chiopis, or rarely cat flea. The mode of transmission in this case is rubbing or scratching on skin or inhalation of fleas, dried feces, and less frequently by the flea bite. The reservoir are rodents Rattus rattus and Rattus norvegicus. The clinical manifestations of the endemic typhus: incubation period is averaging 11 days, ranging from 1 to 2 weeks. Symptoms are similar to epidemic typhus but milder and rarely fatal. Fever, headache, myalgia, anorexia, and rash involving the trunk more often than extremities. Geographical distribution: endemic worldwide, especially in warm tropics, having high rat infestation. So where there are more rats, there is endemic typhus. In India, Shimla, Kashmir, Mumbai, Jabalpur, Lucknow, and Pune are the prominent places of the endemic typhus. Then Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Rocky Mountain spotted fever is a type of spotted fever. It's caused by Rickettsia rickettsii. The vector is tick, and transmission is by tick bite. The reservoir tick serves as a vector as well as a reservoir. The other mammals which are involved are dogs and the small rodents. Clinical manifestations: the incubation period varies from 4 to 14 days. There is fever, headache, and rash, and frequently myalgia and anorexia are there. Rashes are there on the extremities, wrist and ankles, and trunk. Initially, there is maculopapular rash. Later on, it becomes hemorrhagic. Complications appear late. Vascular damage, increased permeability, edema, hemorrhage, disseminated intravascular coagulation, interstitial pneumonitis, CNS involvement, myocarditis, or renal failure may be there. And this Rocky Mountain spotted fever is the most fatal of the rickettsial diseases. Geographical distribution: Rocky Mountain spotted fever is endemic in high tick population area of US, Central and South America. It's more common during the tick season, the summer in the tropics, and among children and males. Then Indian tick typhus. This is caused by Rickettsia cunori. The vector transmitting is tick. The clinical manifestations are similar to Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Eschar at the site of tick bite is there in 50% of the cases. Geographical distribution: R. cunori is prevalent in southern Europe, Africa, and southern Asia. In India, the Indian tick typhus is widespread in Nagpur, Jabalpur, Sagar, Pune, Lucknow, Bengaluru, and Secunderabad. Rickettsial pox is caused by Rickettsia acari. The vector is infected mite. The reservoir is mice. Clinical manifestations are similar to other rickettsial diseases but differ from the latter by the presence of vesicular rash, eschar, and regional lymphadenopathy. Geographical distribution: endemic in USA, Ukraine, Turkey, and Mexico. Then now we will see the general account of the laboratory diagnosis of the rickettsiosis or the rickettsial infection. Serology is one of the important methodology of the diagnosis. A non-specific test known as Weill-Felix reaction, because there is cross-reaction between the antibodies, the rickettsial antibodies against Proteus strains of OX19, OX2 and OXK. These are done. It is also done in our center, our laboratory CCL microbiology section here. There is a very vague test, but still this is being used. In epidemic and endemic typhus, there is increase in OX19 antibody. In tick-borne spotted fever, there is increase in the OX19 and OX2 antibodies. And in scrub typhus, there is increase in OXK antibody. So this rough assumption is used in the diagnosis. Then specific antibody detection by indirect immunofluorescence, ELISA, and indirect immunoperoxidase assay can also be done. Then histological examination for the diagnosis. A cutaneous biopsy sample from rash is useful. The culture is by inoculating into the cell lines, the virocell lines, WI38, HeLa, or the embryonated egg, or the animal guinea pig. These days, PCR detecting gene encoding 16S ribosomal RNA or OMP genes is also used. Treatment. Doxycycline for 1 to 5 days is the drug of choice for most rickettsial illnesses. Chloramphenicol is an alternative drug. Prevention. Vector control strategies such as use of insecticides, control of rodents and other animals, improvement of personal hygiene. No vaccine is available at present against rickettsial infections. Only research and trials are going on. Then the scrub typhus or Orontia. Scrub typhus or Orontia is caused by Orontia tsushugamushi. Earlier it was known as Rickettsia tsushugamushi. It is different from Rickettsia both genetically and by its cell composition. These Orontia or the Orontia tsushugamushi, they lack LPS layer in their cell wall. The name scrub typhus has arisen because it occurs in the scrub vegetations consisting of low-lying trees and bushes. Vector is trombiculid mites. The trombiculid mites or chiggers, they bite. That is why it is also known as chiggerosis, because this is the only stage which feeds on the humans. And these mites also maintain the trans-ovarian transmission. Clinical features. The triad of clinical manifestation is eschar at the site of the bite, regional lymphadenopathy, and maculopapular rash. Non-specific symptom along with this triad are fever, headache, myalgia, cough, and GI symptoms. The complication may be of encephalitis and interstitial pneumonia. The epidemiology, the genotic tetrad is trombiculid mite, small mammals, for example, field mice, rats, and shrews. The number 3 is secondary scrub vegetation or forest, and 4th is the wet season during which the mites lay eggs. The world scenario of the scrub typhus is, there is a triangle known as Shushugamishi triangle around the river of the Shushugamishi, which extends from Japan, Russia in the north to Australia in the south and to Pakistan in the west. Indian scenario is, This disease is re-emerging in sub-Himalayan belt, Bihar, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Pondicherry and Kerala. There is a rural to urban shift, mainly reported from rural areas. Recently, cases have been increased in the urban areas also. The drug of choice for treatment is doxycycline. Chloramphenicol or azithromycin is given alternatively. Laboratory diagnosis. Serology is the mainstay of diagnosis. In primary infection, IgM antibodies appear by the end of the first week and IgG by the end of the second week. In reinfection, IgG antibodies are detectable by sixth day, with IgM antibodies being variable. Wilfelix test, non-specific test, detects high titers of heterophil antibodies to protease OXK antigen. Indirect immunofluorescence antibody, gold standard for the serological test. It is done to confirm the diagnosis. ELISA is performed by using the 56 kilodalton recombinant major surface antigen, and this is common and cost effective, and this is equivalent to immunofluorescence antibody test. And molecular test consisting of the PCR for the detection of the major 15 kilodalton gene, 47 kilodalton gene and 16S ribosomal RNA gene is also done. Fever caused by Coxsilla Burnetii. Q fever is caused by an organism which is obligate intracellular parasite. For a long time, the causative organism of this disease was unknown. That is why it was referred as Qury or Q fever. Later on, the agent was identified and named after their discoverers, Cox and Burnetii, and was named Coxsilla Burnetii. Source of infection is zoonotic. Human infections are from cattle, sheep and goat. Mode of transmission is inhalation of infected dust from soil previously contaminated by urine and feces of diseased animals. So in the animal husbandry, if the cattle are diseased, then there are chances of infection to the workers. Rarely, it can transmit through ingestion of the contaminated milk. So, if the animal is diseased, it is giving the milk, and the Coxsilla Burnetii is in the milk, and if it is not pasteurized, boiled, then if you are consuming the raw milk, you can get it. Geographical distribution. It is endemic in most parts of the world except in New Zealand and Antarctica. In India, it is prevalent in Rajasthan, Punjab, Haryana, and Delhi. Clinical manifestations. The incubation period ranges from 3 to 30 days. There are two types, acute Q fever and chronic Q fever. In acute Q fever, there is hepatitis, interstitial pneumonia, fever, CNS involvement, pericarditis, and myocarditis. In chronic Q fever, which develops after 2 to 3 years after the acute Q fever in 5% cases, it is presented by the endocarditis. Laboratory diagnosis. The Q fever organisms, that is Coxsilla Burnetii, are small pleomorphic gram-negative coccobacilli. The isolation is possible in the media, and it is because it is extremely fastidious. It is done in biosafety level 3 laboratory, and the isolation is done from buffy coat blood samples or tissue specimen by a special technique known as shell vial technique. antibody detection, immunofluorescence, indirect immunofluorescence assay can be done, which is sensitive and method of choice. Molecular method, PCR detection is possible by detecting the specific DNA in tissue specimens. Treatment, the doxycycline is drug of choice, doxycycline for 14 days. Quinolones are alternative and effective drugs. In chronic Q fever, hydroxychloroquine is added to alkalinize the phagolysosome and to render doxycycline bactericidal against the organism. Otherwise, the doxycycline is bacteriostatic. Prevention, vaccine inactivated vaccine of whole cell is licensed in Australia. It is known as QVAX. This is recommended for occupationally exposed workers. So, if you are an animal husbandry practices, then you are at risk of the Q fever, so you can go for vaccination. Good animal husbandry practices should be followed to prevent from the Q fever. And pasteurization of milk is very much needed because the chances are there to be organism to be there in the milk. So flush method is okay for the safety, and flush method is nothing but heating of the milk in a flash for 20 seconds followed by rapid cooling to 13 degree centigrade or lower and keeping it at that. Then the last of the rickettsial organisms, Bartonellosis. Bartonella are the fastidious facultative intercellular gram-negative bacteria. They have got the ability to invade mammalian cells and RBCs. The three important human pathogens are B. henseli, B. quintana, and B. baciliformis. B. henseli is transmitted by the exposure to cat, by scratch or bite. So there is a cat scratch disease in which there is a regional lymphadenopathy and painless papule at the site of scratch, or it is bacillary angiomatosis, where new vascular lesions involving skin and other organs are there, or bacillary pelliosis, where there is angioproliferative disorder involving liver and spleen. The second is B. quintana. It is transmitted by louse. It can cause trench fever, which is a mild febrile illness. Lasts for 5 days and subsequent episodes occurring every 5 days, so it is also known as 5-day fever. Or bacillary angiomatosis can occur, chronic bacteremia can occur, or endocarditis may occur. B. baciliformis, it is transmitted by the sand fly. It can produce a biphagic disease. Oroya fever or carrion disease can produce verruca peruana or other diseases like bacteremia and endocarditis. Laboratory diagnosis of the Bartonella infections, the sample is blood, lymph or skin biopsies. In microscopy, Parthen styrene silver nitrate staining and immunofluorescence staining are done, which are done to detect B. henseli from lymph node smears. Culture, Bartonella can be grown on blood agar 37 and incubated for 12 to 15 days. Antibody detection can also be done by IFA, immunoassay, and they detect against both antibodies against B. henseli and B. quintana separately. The PCR can also be done to detect the genes which are, for example, 16S rRNA gene. treatment. Cat scratch disease treatment is not indicated routinely, but if there is a extensive lymphadenopathy, azithromycin for 5 days can be given. Bacillary angiomatosis, azithromycin or doxycycline for 3 months are to be given. Thank you very much for the prolonged but still informative lecture, which you listened carefully and patiently. Thank you.